Hi, welcome back to my new glasses. Also, I got this new shirt. It's rally possum time, bitch. This is actually American culture on a t-shirt. This is both equally the most awesome thing that I have in my wardrobe and also the most cursed. Guys, welcome to my living room. Today, we're gonna try to not die from heat stroke and also talk about Only Murders in the Building season 4. It has been a little bit of time since I have talked about it, and I think it was good. It was like a good healthy purge for my brain, so I didn't have to say words like gooseberry theater, Schmackery's cookie, and our catacombs 50,000 times when making a video. But now I feel like an appropriate amount of time has passed, and I am amped to talk about this upcoming season, which is set to air on Hulu on August 27th of 2024. Now, we have some information that has been released in the last couple weeks about this upcoming season, so I thought it would be an appropriate time now to kind of dip our toe in the water that is Only Murders in the Building. Talk about the information that we do know, both in the teaser trailers and the pictures that have been released about this series thus far, and also talk about who our mastermind is going to be going forward in the show and kind of like do a little bit of a tier list situation. If you don't know why I'm accusing someone of being a mastermind, we'll talk about that in a little bit. Spoiler alert!
Spoiler!
If you have not seen Only Murders in the Building through seasons 1 through 3, or spoiler alert,
spoiler!
If you really don't want to know anything about what's going to happen in season 4, and without further ado, let's get started. Hi everyone, it's me, voiceover Megan, here to give you a very friendly reminder of all the things that we learned about this season's murder mystery and the final moments of season 3. But before we do that, let's take a moment to familiarize ourselves with Saz, the murder victim of season 4. Saz, as we know, is played by the absolutely brilliant, literally have never seen her in anything where she didn't absolutely crush it, Jane Lynch. Like even in that one episode of The West Wing, season 2, episode 1, where she plays reporter number 3 and has 2 speaking lines of dialogue, she absolutely crushed that shit. I love Jane Lynch, I cannot stress that enough. But anyways, what was I talking about again? Saz, as we find out in the show, is Charles's old stump double from his days on Brazos, and who makes her first appearance in season 1, episode 9. We learn immediately that Saz dresses exactly like Charles, moves exactly like him, and it almost becomes a running joke in the show that everyone who meets Saz initially thinks that she's Charles. Saz was much more popular on the set of Brazos with the cast and crew than Charles was, big shocker there, and even in fact stole one or two of Charles's girlfriend in the past. Saz also shows herself to be a pretty decent detective in this episode. She kind of talks about evidence that the trio overlooked and points them to the fact that this was a crime of passion, which in turn leads them to realize that Jan was the killer. Saz then appears again in season 2 when we find out that she is the stunt double for Brazos in the reboot, which once again reminds us of the fact that even in the fictional world of Only Murders in the Building, there are unnecessary reboots of classic television shows that absolutely nobody asked for.
I want soup!
Saz helps Charles break up with Jan, who's still serving time in prison, but in the process also starts a relationship with Jan. Saz then reappears again in season 3, episode 5, in order to congratulate Charles and Joy on their recent engagement. She helps Charles realize that he needs to figuratively and literally embrace Joy, but unfortunately because Charles is an absolute clown in the third season, Joy leaves him for Scott Bakula. Now at the time, I will fully admit, I thought Saz's appearance in season 3 was a one-off fan service moment and an excuse for Charles to talk to someone about his relationship issues with Joy. And I continued to think that until the very final moments of season 3. Saz is, you know, again, kind of felt like a little bit of a filler moment, but as soon as Saz reappeared within moments of the final episode, I could not have been more wrong and could not have been more stoked. I literally said out loud, oh my god, they're gonna kill Saz, and I could not be happier about this, but also respectfully rest in peace. So basically, Saz walks through the door to congratulate Oliver on his successful opening night of Death Rattle Dazzle, you know, if you ignore the fact that Cliff tried to jump down on stage and confess to the murder of Ben Glenroy. She carries a box of Belgian beer in her arm, takes a selfie with Charles, everyone's super excited to see her, and of course she is wearing the exact same outfit as her former co-worker, and she pulls Charles aside and asks if she can speak to him in private about a sensitive matter. Charles says, sure, let me just go to my apartment first and get a special bottle of wine for the occasion, but before he does, he gets a text from Joy about her new boyfriend, Scott Bakula.
It's not romantic.
We then cut to several shots of Charles's empty, dark, still apartment. Someone we assume to be Charles enters, walks through to the kitchen, and is shot by a single gunshot. The scene switches to Oliver and Mabel chatting at Oliver's party, where Howard comes over into the kitchen kitchen, sounding a little bit concerned, asking if anyone has seen Charles. We then cut back to the dead body, and we find out that it's in fact Saz, not Charles, who was shot in the kitchen and is currently bleeding out on the ground. Charles enters the kitchen back at Oliver's apartment, asks if anyone has seen Saz with that wine, and the final moments of this episode show Saz lying on the ground bleeding out, dipping her fingers in the gunshot wound, and trying to write something on the floor. What a fucking ending. Bravo, writers. Please do not fuck this up in season 4. So going into season 4, I kind of have this list of questions that I want to pay attention to when talking about this mystery and trying to figure out what exactly happened to Saz based on the information that we've been provided. Number 1, who shot Saz? Feels pretty self-explanatory. If we don't figure this out, I think the show has some bigger issues to sort out. Number 2, did Saz have time to talk to Charles before getting shot? We see the scene jump from Charles deciding to go get the wine and then Saz entering the apartment to go get the bottle of wine, but we have no idea how much time has passed between one moment to the other. What does Saz want to talk to Charles about? Is it something that had to do with the people that apparently wanted Charles dead instead of Ben Glenroy, as Saz mentions in season 3, episode 5?
By the way, are we sure that the killer was after Ben and not you, Charles?
What?
Oh, I've been getting some vibes. And I also have my ham radio. And there's chatter of people wishing it was you.
Who is the intended target of the gunshot? Now, logic here tells me that it was likely Charles who is the intended target because we aren't gunning someone down in Saz's kitchen, you know what I mean? Saz also dresses and moves exactly like Charles, and if the room is dark and far away, and it's Charles's apartment, I would think the attacker was trying to shoot down Charles and probably thought that Saz was him. Charles, throughout this series, has also made many enemies with the podcast and accusing many powerful people of murder and exposing a lot of their deep, dark secrets, so I feel like it's pretty safe to assume that it's Charles, but you absolutely never know. Why did Saz decide to get the bottle of wine from Charles's apartment, and was she really getting wine? Was the wine just an excuse to go to Charles's apartment to get something else? Was she just being a good friend? Who the hell knows? Why was Howard looking for Charles, and why did he seem somewhat concerned when he was looking for him? From where was the bullet shot? Charles is on the 12th floor, so physics says either they were shooting from across the way at another apartment on the 12th floor, from the penthouse, which is the only place above him, or the roof. Who has access to these places? A resident, perhaps? Was this the work of a hired gunman, or is Uma at the gun range practicing mowing people down from 200 feet away on the weekends? I want to say it was a hired gun, but you never know. You absolutely never know. What was Saz writing on the floor? Was it a clue? Was it a warning? Was it just an involuntary movement of her arm as she's dying on the ground? And finally, number 10, did Saz know who shot her?
Coochie coochie coo. What if none of it is true?
I think we can continue now. Now that we have established all of the information about Saz, our murder victim, as well as what exactly happened to her at the end of season 3, let's now talk about what we know about season 4. I'm going to be talking not only about the teaser trailer, I'm going to be talking about the pictures that were released by the cast members, as well as the things that were released by Hulu. Also going to be talking about pictures that were circulated of people just spotting the show being filmed around New York City, and there does happen to be a couple spoilers about what probably will happen in those pictures. So if you don't want to know any of that, skip ahead a little bit. I just want to make that very clear. So typically when I talk about teaser trailers on this channel, I go through the teaser trailer and then pause when I want to say something, which is usually like every 3 or 4 seconds approximately. This teaser trailer in particular is kind of tricky because it really just functions for the purposes of like telling you that we're going to go to LA this season and then just like unloading all of the different people that are going to be guest appearances in this 4th season. I have just put together main takeaways and observations that I have gotten from this little bit of curated information. So let's just go through my notes. Oh, what just happened? So one of the first things I notice in this trailer, we get to see a very quick image of the gunman's hand. Now, like I mentioned in my last section, we don't actually technically know right now if the person who shot Saz is the person who wanted her dead or Charles dead. Looking at the hand itself, I think it kind of looks like a man's hand, but you know, I could be wrong. I think they probably try to make that shit look ambiguous just in case so they can make it be technically anybody, but it's the cuticles just kind of look like they're manly. You know what I mean? Charles, Mabel, and Oliver, I feel like a lot of times in this teaser trailer are just hanging out in Charles's kitchen or in very close proximity to the window after Saz was gunned down and there's theoretically a killer on the loose. I feel like that is kind of unhinged behavior. I don't know if I would feel that comfortable doing that. At one point, Charles is literally like sticking his face like 3 inches away from the gunshot hole that's through the glass in the window in his kitchen. And I'm assuming at this point, if they're still looking at the gunshot hole, they don't know who did it yet. So there's somebody just running
running around trying to kill Charles and or Saz. They're like sitting in the fucking kitchen in robes in broad daylight. Like, that seems just absolutely feral to me. We also find out in this trailer that the characters are going to be going to Los Angeles, which is something that the writers of the show confirmed even before the teaser trailer came out. Charles, Mabel, and Oliver are getting offered the opportunity to make their story about the Tim Kono murder and the podcast creation into a movie, and they're going to LA to kind of negotiate that deal. Now, initially when I heard that they were going to go to LA, I was a little bit apprehensive. I don't want the story to get too derailed and like off center to talk about this other subplot that doesn't really have anything to do with the mystery that took place across the country. Obviously, there could be tie-ins. There could be people that maybe knew Saz because she worked as a stunt woman in Los Angeles. Maybe this is an opportunity for us to investigate Saz's background and kind of rule out whether she was the intended target or not. But I don't want it to turn into something like in season 3 when we were spending so much fucking time at the Gooseberry Theater, where my brain couldn't help but wonder why we're doing this when ultimately it doesn't have anything to do with the mystery at hand. We see Charles, Mabel, and Oliver toasting in the kitchen wearing the same outfits that they were wearing at the party in Oliver's apartment at the end of the 3rd season, and they're toasting in Charles's kitchen. So either this has to be a flashback to a point earlier in the day prior to the party where Saz got killed, or they're literally toasting with champagne over Saz's dead body. So now we have approached the part of the trailer where we have an insane amount of guest appearances by big time actors and actresses in this 4th season. I will say this, in the past we have had phenomenal performances by very big name actors and actresses, either playing versions of themselves or playing completely fictional characters, and it doesn't feel distracting. It feels like it meshes well with everything in the show. But I do think sometimes when you have a lot of people showing up in one season, it can feel a little distracting. I think the more and more popular this show gets, the more and more people want to come and be a part of it. Have people just purely for the purposes of stunt casting, I think it gets more obnoxious than it does get exciting. So in this particular season, according to the trailer, in addition to Howard, Saz, Loretta, and Detective Williams, we also have Eva Longoria, Eugene Levy, Zach Galifianakis, which, like, where the fuck did that come from? Molly Shannon, Kumail Nanjiani, Richard Kind, and Melissa McCarthy. That's a lot of people, I feel like, in addition to the other big heavy hitters that we have in this show. I did find out that Eugene Levy, Eva Longoria, and Zach Galifianakis are going to be playing the actors who play Charles, Mabel, and Oliver in this movie that they're going to be making in Hollywood. And I actually think that's kind of funny. I think Eugene Levy being casted as a character that's going to be playing Charles, it just makes sense for some reason. And don't ask me the reason, I couldn't tell you. Whoever decided to put Zach Galifianakis as a character that's going to be playing Martin Short, like, where the fuck did that come from? But you know what? We'll see what happens. I think Molly Shannon is supposed to play one of the producers of the movie, like a big shot Hollywood agent or something. I have no idea who Kumail Nanjiani is supposed to play, but it looks like he's wearing the same Christmas sweater that Ryan Reynolds wore in that one picture of him with Jake Gyllenhaal and Hugh Jackman. So I have no idea what that's about, but I feel like his storyline is going to be related to something in Hollywood. I have no idea who Melissa McCarthy is going to be. It looks like she's kind of in the entryway to Charles's apartment, like, just based on the lighting in the background, but that could be purely speculation. I have no earthly idea. And Richard Kind looks like he is in an Arconia apartment unit and he is wearing an eye patch. So who the fuck knows? Other observations. We have a pig running wild in the hallway. And then we also see Howard kind of pop up a couple times in this trailer. When Zach Galifianakis slaps Oliver in the face, we see Howard standing behind him in the doorway. We also see Howard very briefly leading Charles, Mabel, and Oliver out of Charles's apartment. Charles at one point looked like he's trying to leave his apartment unit, and then the SWAT team busts in. So it's basically the big takeaways. There's like a couple funny bits about Charles thinking that anyone knows who Brazos is, things like that. Looking at the pictures now, there's this picture of Charles, Mabel, and Oliver dressed in the same outfits that they wore the first night of the pilot episode where Tim Kono got murdered, where they all met for the first time. We also have a picture of Oliver wearing this very snappy 80s outfit with a windbreaker and a little headband and some very short shorts. So I'm thinking maybe he might be playing tennis. He's using an umbrella, so I have no earthly idea. I think he's kind of crushing it. I think he looks really good. Selena Gomez wearing a silver blazer with like a tube dress underneath and some like knee-high boots and then a sailor hat. Kind of looks like a weird retro 50s performance outfit. And then Charles and Oliver look like they're wearing the suits that they make the Marvel actors wear when they're trying to like CGI them up to make them look like the Hulk. Now we're gonna move to the pictures that are kind of spoiler-esque. So if you don't want to see those, please look away.
Spoiler! Spoiler!
Apparently, there was a couple pictures that were taken of filming going on in New York City where looks like there is going to be a wedding between Oliver and Loretta. Now, we know that Loretta lives in LA. We see her living in LA in this teaser trailer, and we know that was her intention to go move there when we saw her last in the season 3 finale. So maybe this is like they got married before she left, or maybe she came back to get married. It looks like we have a picture of her just looking absolutely gorgeous, by the way, getting walked down the aisle by Will, which is absolutely adorable. Whoever the person who's officiating needs fucking iron their suit, because this looks really, really messy. Can't tell who's officiating it. It kind of looks like a hat that fucking Saz would wear, but obviously she's dead. Unless if this is a flashback, then I don't think that would necessarily be possible. We see Oliver wearing a purple suit, which honestly, that feels like kind of tame for his wedding day, but you know, whatever. We see Lester in the background here, and then in the corner here, we see Charles wearing a powder blue suit. We have an image here of Howard, who looks like he has a little stroller, which is the stroller that Oliver uses to transport Winnie around. Now, I don't see Mabel in any of these pictures, and I don't see Dickie in any of these pictures, and Dickie is Loretta's son and agent, so maybe they're just in other stills. These were apparently taken by the paparazzi, so they might not have been able to get everything from any angle, but I would think that Mabel would be involved in this wedding at some point.
Okay guys, we're at the point in the video where we can now talk about the Moriarty type mastermind figure in Only Murders in the Building. This is what I was waiting for. This is the part of the video where I'm probably going to lose my mind, partially from the fact that I have talked about this on my channel way too much and way too often, but also because the heat in my living room has reached dangerous levels where I might pass out.
So you're probably wondering, Megan, you keep talking about this mastermind Moriarty figure in the context of Only Murders in the Building. Like, why do you keep doing that? Like, what has possessed you to assume this to be true? And if you are thinking that, that tells me, one, you haven't seen my Sting Theory video, which is extremely hurtful. I spent a year making that video. Please go watch it. And two, you probably don't spend a lot of time on Reddit. So allow me to just briefly explain the purpose of this tier list. So here's the thing about me. I really like this show. I feel like season one of Only Murders in the Building set a very high bar for me. One of my favorite first seasons of television that has ever existed. The murder mystery was very good, but it was not perfect. There were a couple flaws, couple loose ends, and things like that that were not addressed after the end of the first season. I didn't really think too much of it though, because I assumed that some of these loose ends would be things that would be addressed later in the series. Now, after watching season two, we know what happened there. Not only were these loose ends not addressed, but we had an entire fucking army of additional loose ends that when you take into account the fact that they exist, it makes certain things in the show, including but not limited to the murder itself and the mystery and the explanation given to us, not make any sense at all. It's not like, oh, there's like a one-off continuity issue. It's like literally a list of 30 things.
Why did someone at the police station stop the toxicology report from being submitted or Tim Kono's phone from being analyzed? Who poisoned Winnie and left a threatening note on Oliver's door? Who left a threatening note on Jan's door? Why was there a different handwriting in Tim Kono's fake suicide notes in the trash? Why did Jan throw away the glasses that she used to poison Tim Kono's drink along with the suicide notes when she could have just washed them? Especially when she had the glasses in the same bag as the suicide notes that she wrote for Tim Kono and intended for them to be found. How did Poppy find out about the tunnels in the Arconia? What was Ursula throwing away in season 2, episode 2? Where the hell did Oscar go in season 2? Where the hell is Mabel's aunt? Why did the flashback in season 1 say Mabel's aunt lived in apartment 10A when in the present, Bunny now lives in 10A? How did Howard get a black eye? Did Nina really punch him? How did Poppy know Lucy was in the tunnels on the night of Bunny's murder? How was there a bloody fingerprint on the matchbook found in the tunnels? Who was Bunny really eating with on the surveillance footage at the Pickle Diner the night before she died? Why was Bunny giving Ivan so much money all the time? Why did Poppy think a murder would lead to a podcast from Cindy Canning? Why was Poppy asking Bunny for the painting even as recently as the day Bunny died? How was Poppy able to plant all of the evidence and get out of the building and run into Lucy and meet Cindy Canning outside the Arconia before the cops or anyone noticed she was gone? Why did Poppy say that Mabel finding the dead body instead of running out of the building as she instructed was what ruined her plan? How did nobody in Poppy's hometown recognize her just because she was wearing different glasses and cut her hair? Who is the Sixth Avenue killer? How did Charles's father have a Rose Cooper address engraved in his watch when he never saw her after faking Rose's disappearance?
So at the end of the second season, I took to Reddit because, you know, that's where I go to kind of vent my feelings and frustrations about television shows in my life. And I found that a lot of people felt the same way. And there was a Ask Me Anything thread in one of the Only Murders in the Building pages hosted by one of the writers of the show, Jonathan Hoffman. And a lot of people were asking the same questions, like, what happened to Winnie? Who poisoned Winnie? Who put the note on Jan's door? Things like that. Writer for this show made a comment that A, many of the loose ends were left open by design, and B, some of the loose ends would be answered by a Moriarty / Mastermind figure that would be introduced at some point later in the series. Now, this really got me cooking. I was like, oh boy, there's a big plan. So I thought it would be fun to kind of accuse a random person of being a mastermind in a fictional murder. So I picked Sting because why the fuck not? I thought that would be funny and my friend suggested it and I was like, sure, I'll do that. And then I realized that Sting is actually probably the mastermind, and if he is, I will literally never let anybody forget it for the rest of my life that I called that shit like a year in advance. But I basically kind of have been operating under the assumption ever since I saw those posts, and it's been kind of widely circulated in the Only Murders in the Building community, that there is going to be a mastermind at some point. When we found out that Saz was gunned down in Charles's apartment, it kind of got me thinking that this Moriarty excuse would actually be something that would come into existence in this next season. Is this maybe the writers talking out of their ass to make people happy? Sure, maybe. But you know what? I'm gonna try to pretend that this is true and see if we can figure out, going into this fourth season, the likelihood of some of the characters we know thus far, whether they could be a mastermind, and kind of rank them accordingly. Thinking of a mastermind, they have to have the means and the motive to be able to put something into place. And according to the writers for this show as well, they also have indicated that the loose ends would be explained by this Moriarty / mastermind figure. So I think looking at some of the loose ends and what their relationship could be to this potential mastermind would be important to consider as well. Hi, hello, it's a new day. It is a still warm day, but not as disgustingly hot as it was yesterday. So we are here to try to film the rest of this video and hopefully I won't pass out. Let us talk about our tier list. I'm extremely excited about this. This started as a pre-made tier list on TierMaker, but there was a lot of people that I felt were missing. So what I did was I added additional characters that I thought were relevant to this discussion and then added categories according to who I have included. Not every single person from the cast of Death Rattle Dazzle is represented in this tier list. If Bobo ends up being the mastermind that we have been looking for, I will cut my own foot off and eat it on camera, but I don't think that's necessarily going to happen. So with all that being said, let's go through our categories. At the top of the list, this shouldn't be a surprise to anybody, I have my Sting category. This is the hill that I'm basically forced to die on at this point. Below that, in our extremely sus category, these are people that I would not really be surprised at all if the writers went ahead and made them mastermind. These are people that I feel like if you went back and created a narrative to make sense for why they were a mastermind or what they did, it wouldn't derail their depiction too much, and there's certain things about them that are maybe pretty suspicious consistently throughout the story. Below that, we have Dark Horse. These are people that maybe there are certain aspects about them that make sense for being a mastermind, but there's also things that maybe contradict this narrative or things that we've seen about them that would kind of make it not quite a perfect fit, but we want to acknowledge the fact that we are kind of suspicious of them. Below that, we have Remote Chance but Not Likely. So I envision these people to be either individuals we just don't know enough about to make a definitive statement one way or the other. We're just at a point where we have a lack of data. Or these are people where there's just a lot of contradicting information that would make it kind of a hard sell to make them a mastermind. Below that, we have people I am pretty much confident that they're not the mastermind, so we have No Chance in Hell. Below that, we have Dead People. And then below that, we have Charles, Mabel, and Oliver. And I know there are a lot of people in the Only Murders in the Building Reddit pages that really are sold on the fact that Charles, Mabel, and or Oliver is some sort of mastermind genius that is playing the long con in this series. I personally cannot get behind those series. We have seen so much of these characters and seen them in so many situations where they are acting genuinely without anyone else around them, so there's no reason to pretend or feign some sort of response in a given context. I feel like that would just be a very extremely hard thing for the writers to do to make that make any bit of sense whatsoever. These people would have to be the most insane sociopathic liars to themselves and to everyone else around them for that to make any bit of sense. But again, if that ends up being the case, I will eat my foot, okay? I think our first person here is Alice. I feel like we've seen not that much of her, and I don't think we've heard anything about her since season 2. She was only in that season as a guest role. It's not necessarily saying you still can't be a mastermind if you've only been in a couple episodes. However, I definitely feel like Alice's motivations were revealed and made clear in that second season. She was trying to just use Mabel as a way to access this weird trauma art display that she was doing. I don't necessarily see how that would maybe work. I also don't think Alice is really smart enough to be a mastermind, to be honest with you. I feel like she's just kind of not a great person, but not because she's a mastermind. So I'm gonna put her in no chance in hell. I feel pretty confident about that. So we know Saz is dead, so we'll put her in dead people. May she rest. Now we have Howard. Now, Howard is always just kind of on my list for being suspicious because he always just does suspicious things. I feel like it's a weird joke in the writer's room at this point to make Howard do randomly strange things that kind of just seem not quite right, and they're never really fully explained by any point, and you don't really know if he's telling the truth when he does explain them. He's always around. Like, in season one, he was a suspect for the murder of Tim Kono. We obviously know he didn't do it, but he had a motive to not like Tim because Tim was always really rude to his cat, and then his cat died because of Tim Kono. He had a black eye, and I don't even think it was fully explained. I think Nina was supposed to have punched him. He auditioned for a role in Oliver's play that he didn't get and ended up being assistant for the whole production. Always just there. So I think the opportunity to have insight and information as to all of the victims we've seen thus far, as well as Charles, Mabel, and Oliver, is certainly present. We don't always fully know what's going on and whether he's really telling the truth. That said, he also, we have seen, has been helpful in certain situations. He's given certain insight as to Nina and what's going on in season two. And then in season three, he's working for Oliver. And we see in the teaser trailer, he seems like he's working closely with them again. I feel like I could put him in extremely sus just out of principle because Howard's always kind of extremely sus. But I feel like if I put him any lower, this is going to be the opportunity where the writers are like, okay, now we're going to make Howard do something. So I feel like I have to put him in there and we're just going to leave it at that. For reasons I already explained, I'm going to just put Oliver, Mabel, and where do you go? Charles into the Charles, Mabel, and Oliver category. Put Mrs. Gambolini in here. I'm going to put her in no chance in hell. Then we have Rose Cooper, who was struggling to slice a piece of cheese in half. So I'm going to confidently put her in no chance in hell as well. Theo Demas. Okay. Initially, when I was thinking about making this tier list, I was like, oh my god, Theo would be the perfect person. And I've seen people say that in my comment section as well. On the one hand, he has a perfect motive and he has a perfect means and opportunity to do so. Podcast, Only Murders in the Building, basically outed not only his secret about accidentally killing Zoe in the first season, but also the grave robbing business. They got in trouble for that because of Charles, Mabel, and Oliver's investigation. Maybe he was pretending to be a better person in seasons two and three. We see that he becomes a good friend to Mabel, so it's possible maybe he's just playing the long con to get some good information and to earn her trust. But we also do see situations with Theo to be maybe more earnest and maybe a better person as a result of everything that happened. He is arguing with his dad in a moment where he doesn't know that Oliver's watching through the catacombs, and he's like yelling at his dad, telling him to stay away from him and that he doesn't want to have anything to do with all the stuff that's been going on for all of his life. I will say maybe Theo realistically was the one that poisoned Winnie if the cowards at Hulu don't decide to embrace Sting Theory. In season one, episode three, he was in the room when Teddy and Oliver were talking about a podcast that Oliver wanted to make about a murder that occurred in the building, and that's specifically how Oliver phrased it. We know that Theo can only catch maybe about a third of the lip readings when he just watches people talk, and so maybe he just caught a podcast about murder in building, just assumed that it was about Zoe because that's the one he accidentally committed, and then decided to poison Winnie because he wanted to prevent the podcast from happening. It's very important to remember that only a very select few people knew about the podcast at the time when he was attacked, and technically Theo was one of them. So I do think that Theo maybe did that, but I don't think he's necessarily the perfect fit, and I would also just personally be kind of disappointed to see that he's the mastermind, because I do think Mabel needs good friends. If he is a liar, then he is an extremely good one. So I'm actually going to put Theo in Dark Horse, because I think there's some contradicting information, but I do think there's certain aspects about him that make him a decent candidate. Nina, we haven't really heard or seen much from Nina other than season two. She was Bunny's replacement for the president of the board of the Arconia. She definitely has some like power trip issues. She's very controlling. She's kind of severe and harsh. She's very organized, and being organized is an extreme threat. As somebody who's very not organized, as you can tell by how I structure my videos, I feel like she could be a remote chance, but not likely. We don't really have the data to kind of definitively say she would have a concrete motive to do this. But now we have Jan. Okay. I'm going to put Jan in Dark Horse, and here's why. I know there are a lot of people that think that she is the one that is the mastermind, and they're very confident about that, but I feel like there's just one too many things about that theory that don't really sit well with me. I think on the one hand, Jan is appealing because she is crazy. It has been implied that prior to Tim Kono, she has killed other people before, so she has the capacity to pull off a crime and get away with it. She's not above doing something insane. She also is not above committing crimes for small things. She thought Tim Kono was cheating on her. He was not cheating on her. He was just collecting jewelry that the Demases were using for their grave robbing stuff, and she assumed that he was going to propose to someone else and murdered him as a result. Oops. If she felt like she was wronged, even in a slight way, I could see her making this whole murder mastermind scheme to get back at somebody because she felt like she was wrong. She also was put in jail because Charles Mabel and Oliver made a podcast about a murder she committed, so there's definitely a lot of strong motive there. She also used to date Charles and was currently dating Saz, presumably, at the time that she died. Regardless of whether the victim was intended to be Saz or whether it was intended to be Charles, you could kind of link her to both of those things. However, I do think there are some logistical issues with her being the person. Jan, I don't necessarily see having like the leverage or the knowledge or the ability to kind of motivate other people to do things for her, unless maybe Saz was acting on her behalf. That would be interesting, actually. And because she's in jail, I don't necessarily know how much intel or information on certain people she would have. Maybe that's why she was trying to date Charles in season 2 to get information from him. There are also certain aspects about things that have transpired, the loose ends that apparently this mastermind is supposed to explain, that don't really seem to add up when it comes to Jan. We have some handwriting samples that have been used to connect Jan to the fake suicide note, but we see there's like notes on her door, notes on Oliver's door that don't match her handwriting at all. There's no way that she could have known about the podcast and left the note on Oliver's door, even if we ignore the fact that the handwriting doesn't match. There was a note left on her own door that wasn't explained, and she looked afraid by it. So I feel like there's certain aspects to the whole Jan explanation that just don't necessarily fully make sense. Again, maybe there's aspects about Jan being the mastermind that explain other things, maybe just not those specific examples, but it just seems like it's kind of a labored point to try to make it work. So I'm gonna put her in Dark Horse and we'll go with that. Lucy, I know, has been a popular suspect ever since season 2. I know there's a lot of people that think that maybe her mother is gonna come back and maybe that Ben Glenroy was her long-lost father or whatever. I feel like at the end of the day, based on what we've seen from Lucy and based on what we've seen from this show, it would be a bit of a hard ask to make Lucy a realistic mastermind. We've also seen Lucy in situations where she was alone and genuinely afraid of, like, for example, when she was hiding in the tunnels and Poppy came and sneezed at her menacingly. So again, unless if she's lying for no one around her just for the purposes of throwing the audience off, I don't think it necessarily makes a lot of sense. I'm gonna put her in remote chance, but not likely. Now we have Detective Williams. So again, similar to Lucy, I feel like we've seen so many examples of Detective Williams trying to do the right thing, trying to give Charles, Mabel, and Oliver a chance to find the right decision. She completely went against what Detective Krebs wanted to do with the investigation in season 2 and went personally to Oliver and Charles to ask them about what was going on so she could try to help them. I don't really think we've ever seen her in any capacity not do the right thing when she has the information in front of her. And she was also the one who discovered by herself with no one else around her that the tox report and the autopsy weren't conducted and the laptop search weren't conducted for Tim Kono in season 1. So I'm gonna put no chance in hell. Another dead person, rest in peace. Poppy, I had so many issues with Poppy being the murderer in season 2. I don't even want to get into it right now. I had an issue with Poppy being the murderer as it was in season 2. Not necessarily the fact that they chose her, but for the reasons given and how she did it, I thought was just a complete mess. So I'm kind of over the whole idea of Poppy being involved in any capacity. The whole murder mystery in season 2 also kind of proved to me that she's really bad at planning mysteries, like way worse than she probably thinks she is. I am gonna put her in no chance in hell as well. Okay, now we have Cindy Canning. I think my brain kind of exploded trying to figure out where to put her. I'm gonna put her in Dark Horse, and here's why. On the one hand, Cinda does fit the basic criteria for what a good mastermind could look like at a bird's eye view. She is extremely rich, extremely powerful. We know that she was purchased for like several million dollars in the first season. We also know that she's extremely cunning and crafty. She's manipulative, she's abrasive, she's competitive. These are all good motivations to get her to be a mastermind in our eyes, even just hypothetically. She wants to be the best podcast out there and she will eliminate competition at all costs. I know there's also a big theory going around about Taubert and Cindy Canning working together in season 3 and that she hired him to kind of get close to Mabel so that he could convince her to go back to the podcasting game and work together with Cinda. I don't know. I feel like maybe that could have happened, but I feel like we probably would have heard that come up at some point. I also don't think Taubert's coming back. I don't know if that'll necessarily resurface or be relevant at all. I could see her being manipulative in that way. I just don't see her being the kind of mastermind that I'm looking for. There are certain situations where if Cinda had known about the stuff going on, then she would have operated in a different way. For example, if she knew anything about what was happening with Jan, she wouldn't be leaving these coy little notes on Jan's door, for example, because we don't know who did that. She would be trying to break the case at all costs. She seems very surprised when she found out that Oliver, Charles, and Mabel broke the case and found out who killed Tim Kono. If she knew anything about it, we probably would have seen her taken more abrasive action first. I also don't think there's literally any way that Cinda Canning would have known about the podcast at the time that Winnie was poisoned, so that's just another thing that she probably wouldn't have been able to figure out. Also, the fact that the police investigation was stopped. Yes, maybe Cinda Canning was powerful enough to be able to stop that investigation, but she wouldn't have had any way to know who Tim Kono was or whether there was a reason to doubt the fact that he committed suicide to stop the police investigation at the time that the autopsy was canceled. If she is a mastermind, then her reach didn't really go that far into some of the loose ends in season 1 or anything like that. The only thing, and it just occurred to me, that maybe I could see her having an involvement in is the fact that she really wants to be the best podcast out there, and maybe she hired someone to shoot Charles. I think that's a little extreme for Cinda Canning, definitely. Her podcast got canceled because of everything that Poppy did.
Poppy, you fucking bitch!
Maybe if she's trying to get back on top and she's worried that this podcast is going to outshine her when she makes her big comeback, and the fact that Mabel doesn't want to work with her because she wants to be loyal to Charles and Oliver, I could see her maybe trying to take some action. Gunning him down, I'm not necessarily sure that's the best option for anybody, but I could maybe see that being a motivation for her to do something as like mastermindy going forward. We also thought she was a mastermind in season 2 and we disproved that, so to go back to her as a mastermind would be kind of annoying. So Tim Kono's dead. We literally have not heard anything about Oscar since like the second episode of season 2. I think at this point he's so far removed from everything else going on, we just don't have enough information to put together a good theory. So I would put him in remote chance, but not likely. Loretta, I'm gonna say no chance in hell because I believe in love. Uma, I would say remote chance, but not likely. Well, actually, I'm gonna put her in dark horse because Uma does know a lot about what's going on. She lived at the Arconia for a long time. She has the opportunity to know a lot of the secrets that are happening with everybody in this series, and she was connected in some way to the people that were killed at the Arconia. They were all technically residents of that building, and she just kind of seems to like be one of those elderly women who just knows all the gossip, so I could see her just having a lot of leverage by way of knowledge and information on people. Do I think, based on what we know about Uma, that she's like a killer? Maybe not, but like Poppy didn't really seem like a killer either in season 1, so who the fuck knows at this point. I also said there was no way on God's green earth that I thought Cliff could kill anybody, and he ended up being a murderer. Amy Schumer, absolutely not. Will, I don't think he's that type of character in this show. I don't want to again speak out of turn and then have him murdering everybody in sight. Matthew Broderick, I'm gonna put him in no chance in hell too. Okay. Here we go. I think Lester is really sus, and here's why. I would just be so tickled to my core if they made Lester the mastermind. He's always just kind of around. He works for the Arconia. He has the opportunity to know literally every single thing about every person that lives there. He would have access to stuff like the Arcatacombs to be able to sneak around and do certain things. I don't necessarily know what his motive would be, but I feel like he's one of those perfect people that's like in the background, but he's always like visible in the background, and he could have a hidden motive that could just come out of nowhere. I think that would be really fun. I'm also gonna put Ursula next to him. I, in my brain, see Ursula and Lester working together. Ursula in particular is somebody who's a huge opportunist. We see that she like is constantly selling products to people to get money, and she has information on everybody. She has files literally of information about complaints that have been filed against certain people at the Arconia. She's like trading secrets with people that come to her and buy cases of gut milk. If Ursula was presented with a proper opportunity opportunity to earn certain money, and she would betray literally every person on this list in order to do that. Now, we don't necessarily know a clear motive for them, but that's something that can be crafted going forward. I just would love to see the people you least expect, the people that operate from the shadows, having something major to do with some of the unexplained questions, because they see everything, they know everything. I think that would be great. Now, I have this question mark here because, like I said, it is entirely possible that the mastermind could be somebody that we don't know yet. I would honestly hate that, I'm not gonna lie, but I feel like it's also a realistic possibility. I think that the show is kind of just winging it as they go with certain things. I remember they said that they just kind of picked Poppy going into season two, not because they planned it out in advance from season one, but because the writers of the show really liked the actress, so they just kind of made it work. I could see them doing that with like a new person that they fall in love with and be like, oh my god, this character is great, let's make them the mastermind, and then just kind of like make shit up to make it make sense for what happened in the past. I see that being more realistic than them saying we've had this plan all along and it was Howard from the start. Dickie, I'm gonna put remote chance but not likely. Again, it's like we don't really know that much about him, and he's really only involved in season three, which took place a year after everything occurred in seasons one and two. Teddy Demas, I'm gonna put Teddy Demas in the same category as his son for a lot of the similar reasons as Theo. He has a lot of money and he has a very strong motive because Charles, Mabel, and Oliver essentially wronged him by exposing his grave robbing business and getting him in legal trouble as a result. Also wrongfully accusing him of a murder, but you know, he did kind of cover up a murder, but just not the murder that they were talking about. But anyway, in terms of some of the loose ends, while yes, he was one of the people that knew about the podcast at the time that the podcast was released and when Winnie was poisoned, he did offer to fund the podcast. So I feel like it would be a weird choice to give Oliver $35,000 and then be like, oh, but actually I'm gonna poison your dog and tell you not to do it. I also think we've already like accused him of being a mastermind and then he was wrongfully accused again. So to bring him back and make him actually the mastermind again, similar to Cinda Canning, it's like we've already kind of done that. It's not to say that he couldn't just turn around and do it again. Just because you're wrongfully accused of something at one point doesn't mean you can't do the thing that you were wrongfully accused for at some point in the future. But I feel like for the purposes of the show and doing new things, I feel like bringing that back and doing that exact thing again might not necessarily be the most entertaining thing in the eyes of the writer. Marv, I'm gonna put him in Dark Horse just because Marv gives off very strange energy. He is like very obsessive about true crime podcasts. He loves Only Murders in the Building. I don't quite know what's going on in that head of his, which makes me feel like he's a bit of a wild card, and I feel like wild cards kind of like inherently go in the Dark Horse category. Marv also works at the Arconia and knows about the catacombs. He was working on mold removal and has one of those hazmat suits that we saw Poppy use in season two as well. He does have certain aspects about him that maybe gives him access to information more so than others. What his motive would be, I have no idea. Maybe because they just don't upload quickly enough, I don't know. He was talking a lot about the Sixth Avenue Killer in that one episode of season two, so maybe he is the Sixth Avenue Killer. That would be fucking crazy. So maybe he's like just a fucking murderer and he just like zigzags in and out of the catacombs and tries to have people killed. Jonathan, I don't really know much about him other than his allergies to cats and the fact that he has stage fright. So I'm gonna put him here. Scott Bakula, I've seen a lot of Reddit posts talking about how Scott Bakula wants to kill Charles because he's jealous of his and Joy's relationship and then he killed Staz on accident and this and that. I don't even know if Scott Bakula knows that this show exists, to be quite honest with you. Maybe he does, maybe he doesn't. Maybe they're keeping that under wraps and he's gonna be a surprise appearance at some point. But I'm gonna put remote chance but not likely because I'm accusing Sting of being a mastermind, so who's to say that Scott Bakula can't be either. Joy, I would say no chance in hell. This woman does not have the composure to be a mastermind. I would have put Taubert in... I wish I knew if he was going to be in the season. If he was going to be in the season, I would put him in Dark Horse. I don't think he's going to be a mastermind that explained literally everything that's ever happened in this series. He's a little shady and he does lie. We know the first thing he ever told Mabel was a lie. I also remember seeing comments by the writers saying that they just wanted Mabel to have a nice steady boyfriend who is a nice guy and doesn't have an ulterior motive like Alice. So I'm going to put him in remote chance but not likely. If I find out at any point that he's going to be in the season, then maybe I'll bump him up a category. Bunny is dead. May she rest. And now we finally have Sting. Now here's the thing. I'm not going to rehash Sting theory for you. If you haven't already watched it, like, What are you still doing here? I will concede that Sting Theory only covers seasons 1 and 2 of Only Murders in the Building. Season 3 was just kind of airing episodes at the time that I uploaded that, and also I had no idea that Saz was going to be the murder victim at the end of season 3 either, so really doesn't take into account any of that information, but it does address a lot of the loose ends and how Sting could realistically have been responsible for or explaining some of these loose ends. So while I don't necessarily think that Hulu is going to actually run with this theory, I do feel like I put a pretty decent argument forward. I will also say there was a picture that was released of Selena Gomez, who plays Mabel Mora, watching the basketball game courtside with her boyfriend. I don't remember what his name is. Benny Blanco? I don't know. Sitting next to Selena Gomez's boyfriend is musical superstar Sting. Literally, Sting is sitting with them courtside, and there's pictures of this online. This is also taken at or around the time that production was filming Only Murders in the Building for season 4. So, maybe they just became friends after Sting made a guest appearance on the show in season 1, or maybe Sting is going to be like a surprise appearance in season 4 because he's actually a mastermind, and then after filming for the day, they decided to go catch a basketball game. I don't know, guys. Maybe. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you like this video, make sure to like and subscribe. Let me know down in the comments what I missed in my tier list, what you think of Only Murders in the Building, what you expect to happen in season 4. I hope to God that the trailer for season 4 doesn't drop immediately after I post this video and then make this therefore obsolete. Pretty excited to talk about Only Murders this season. I'm going to be making a video for every episode and then doing a season review like I did last year, so please make sure to look out for that in the future. Come August 27th, I'll be uploading those videos the following Sunday. In the meantime, I'm gonna go pay attention to my cat and turn on the air conditioning because I am like maybe 30 seconds away from passing out, because otherwise my cat will murder me in my sleep. So, bye!